November has always been a tough month for me. Gray, wet skies, cold winds, and not much daylight here in Sweden. But then I look at what the night sky has to offer and realize that three of my all-time favorite deep sky objects are at their best right now. So even if the days can feel bleak, the nights can be magnificent. My name is Tim and you're watching Cosmic Captures. In this video, I will show you what's happening in the night sky, both north and south, and highlight some of the best objects to photograph this month, so you can make most of your clear nights. Let's start by looking at what the moon is doing this month, because it really sets the rhythm for everything else we can capture. The full moon comes on November the 5th, also known as the Beaver Moon. And this year it's also a supermoon, appearing slightly larger and brighter than usual. The last quarter moon follows on November the 12th, and the new moon on November the 20th, bringing the darkest skies of the month perfect for nightscape and deep sky imaging. And finally, on November the 28th, we have the first quarter moon. If you want to plan your imaging session around moonlight, you can download the Moonlight Astrophotography Planner or map at my website cosmiccaptures.com. With the moon out of the way for the second half of the month, November brings a big change to the night sky. The Milky Way core is gone for the season, and in the northwest, Cygnus is slowly setting, taking the last glow of the summer Milky Way with it. But in the east, the winter Milky Way is rising, and with it Orion, one of the most iconic constellations of the night sky. So yes, the summer Milky Way is gone, but long live the winter Milky Way. It's a different kind of beauty, cooler, dustier, and full of bright nebulae that shine all winter long. And if you're looking for a little extra activity in the sky, the Leonid meteor shower peaks on November the 17th to 18th. Just around the new moon, providing ideal dark sky conditions. They bring fast, bright meteors and are well worth heading out for. Meteors and the Milky Way call for wide-angle lenses. But perhaps this month you want to shift gears. November is the perfect time to go a little deeper with your nightscape photography. So swap your wide angle for something in the 85 to 135 mm range and go for some of the jewels this month has to offer, starting with one of my all-time favorites. There are many deep sky targets with names that suggest they resemble something familiar, like a whale, a jellyfish, or a pelican. But IC-1805, the Heart Nebula, might be one of the few that truly lives up to its name. This region has everything a wide-field astrophotographer could wish for. It's large, relatively bright, and packed with beautiful structure and detail. You can frame it wide with a short telephoto lens around 135 mm and include the close-by Sol Nebula. Or zoom in on the heart of the heart, Melotte 15, that twisting corkscrew-like formation at its core. It looks great in broadband, but with narrowband filters, the Heart Nebula really comes alive, revealing intricate filaments of hydrogen, oxygen, and sulfur that makes it one of the most rewarding nebulae to capture this autumn sky. And if you'd like to learn more about what's happening inside this nebula and how to capture it, you will find more details on my website cosmiccaptures.com. When I got my first telescope as a teenager, the next target was one of my absolute favorites. In the eyepiece, it looked like sparkling diamonds on black velvet, with some stars glowing in a soft golden hue. I'm talking about the double cluster in Perseus, also known as Eta and Chi Persei, which lie just next to the Heart and Sol Nebula complex. The double cluster itself is one of the most photogenic star cluster pairs you can capture. It's a great target for smart telescopes and you can get beautiful results even with short exposures. But if you have the patience and a narrowband filter, you will find faint H-alpha emissions glowing in the background, adding yet another layer of depth to this already stunning field. If you've ever taken color wide field images of the Perseus Taurus region, you might have noticed something that looks like a faint streak of red in your photos. That is NGC 1499, better known as the California Nebula. A vast region of glowing hydrogen that owes its red and pink tones to strong H-alpha emission. Your camera can record those colors quite easily, but to the naked eye, the nebula remains completely invisible. If we could see it, we would be amazed by how large it is. The red glow spans an area equivalent to 5 full moons in the sky. But there's more than just hydrogen. There's also a good amount of sulfur and a faint trace of oxygen. And when you combine those using narrowband techniques, the California Nebula transforms into a far more colorful and layered image of this iconic region. The next target, or perhaps I should say the next region, is one of my absolute favorite. I'm talking about the Taurus-Perseus Molecular Cloud Complex. And within it lies the Tangled Reflection Nebula, NGC 1333, also known as the Embryo Nebula. Its soft blue glow comes from starlight scattered by surrounding dust, giving it a completely different appearance from nebulae like the Heart or California. Hidden within those dusty folds are over 100 young stars still forming. It takes long broadband exposures to reveal this fascinating mix of brown dust, blue reflection nebulae, and small red star-forming regions. But the result is one of the most rewarding and natural-looking images you can capture in this part of the sky. The next November target is one of the most beautiful, iconic, and culturally significant deep sky objects in the night sky, the Pleiades. It's one of the few deep sky objects you can even see from a light-polluted city. And throughout history, it has held enormous importance, from mythology to navigation. And they even appear on the Nebra sky disk, one of the oldest depictions of the night sky. The bluish reflection nebula isn't leftover gas from star formation, but an unrelated interstellar dust cloud that the cluster is currently passing through. You can photograph it beautifully with a DSLR, a mirrorless camera, and a 135mm lens. Or use a telescope up to 600mm with an APS-C size sensor to frame the entire cluster perfectly. In my opinion, there is no other cluster that comes close in structure, beauty, and accessibility. And now is the perfect time to photograph it. And there's another reason why I like the Pleiades so much. They were actually the first target I ever photographed when I began my astrophotography journey 4 years ago. But now to you, what was the first deep sky target you ever photographed? Before we move to the Southern Hemisphere, here's a little tip for those of you using star trackers and short telephoto lenses. The Pleiades and the California Nebula aren't that far apart in the sky. And between them lies the beautiful tangled Taurus-Perseus Molecular Cloud Complex. With a lens between 85 and 105 millimeters, you can frame both in a single shot, like a ruby and a sapphire connected by dust. It's one of those compositions I've had on my list for a while. So wish me luck because I'm hoping to capture it this season. And what about you? What's on your list this season? Now let's head south to one of the most underrated galaxies in the sky. This is NGC 1097, a barred spiral galaxy about 45 million light years away in the constellation Fornax. It's a stunning sight for anyone imaging from the Southern Hemisphere, showing off graceful spiral arms and a bright elongated core. At its very center lies a supermassive black hole, surrounded by a delicate ring of star formation that gives the galaxy a distinct, almost hypnotic look in long exposures. It's best captured with long focal lengths, but even with moderate scales, the structure of the bar and the spiral arms is beautifully visible under dark skies. Not far from NGC 1097 lies another southern gem, NGC 1365, the Great Barred Spiral Galaxy. It's one of the most striking barred spirals in the sky, about 56 million light years away, with sweeping arms, dark dust lanes, and a bright central bar that glows with star formation. It's a perfect target for medium to long focal lengths, especially under dark skies where the full spiral pattern comes to life. And if you're imaging with a smart telescope, both NGC 1097 and NGC 1365 are rewarding southern galaxy targets for November. On my website, cosmiccaptures.com, you will find all the details about these galaxies and every other November target. There you can download the Cosmic Astrophotography Planner or CAP, including filter choices, field of view and exposure recommendations, and even smart telescope suitability. This PDF is designed to help you spend less time planning and more time under the stars. And if you, like me, are in the higher northern latitudes, don't dwell on the November blues. Focus on what you can capture this month, because it's one of the most exciting and rewarding seasons of the year. Do you want more ideas for what to photograph? Then check out last month's video. Many of those targets are still in perfect position. I wish you clear skies, and I'll see you in the next video.